let me tell you a little bit about Rabobank first. Let's see. Then I tell you a little bit about background of cooperatives, financing mature, let's say, large cooperatives, financing developing cooperatives. I think that they have to be distinguished, and some conclusions. I think Ross saved me probably 5 minutes of introduction, so thank you very much for that. Just what I would like to say is that we have a 110-year history. Originally fully focused on farmers, agriculture, but during the 60s, Rabobank also started focusing on private individuals. And now, let's say 2013, Rabo is an all-finance bank, especially in the Netherlands, with leading market shares in SME business, wholesale business. Internationally, 100% food and agri-oriented. But it's interesting, if you look at the loan portfolio of Rabobank, not more than 20% of loan portfolio currently is linked to agriculture. So we are an all-finance bank with an agricultural specialization. So we are a Dutch bank, strong cooperative identity. What I said, leading food and agri bank in various important food and agri producing countries. Highest credit worthiness, strong focus on CSR, which is relabeled nowadays as sustainable business development. Just to give you a little bit of insight in the cooperative structure, typically we have, let's say, 136 local banks in the Netherlands, local Rabobanks. And typically these would be branches of a holding with commercial banks. So typically you would have one mother and 136 daughters. In Rabobank is other way around. We have 136 mothers and one daughter, which is Rabobank Netherlands. So that's a different way of looking at it. And in the end, the 136 local Rabobanks are individual legal entities owning Rabo Netherlands. For the regulator sees Rabobank as one group because of the cross-guarantee system. All the banks, all the local banks are guaranteeing each other, including Rabo Netherlands. So we have almost 2 million members. They own, so to say, the 136 local banks, and those local banks, again, own Rabobank Netherlands. I can jump now to Rabo Development, because I think Ross pretty much explained about Rabo International. If you have Rabo International, let's say, fully focusing on the commercial part of the food and agribusiness, the large corporates, say the wholesale part, the other side of the spectrum would be Rabobank Foundation, which is a not-for-profit part of Rabobank. They fully focus on cooperative development and smallholder development. Rabo Development is somewhere in the middle. It started like 25 years ago as the advisory branch of Rabobank, transferring knowledge on rural banking to developing countries. And it was called RIAS, maybe you remember that. In the course of time, RIAS got a lot of projects with many banks in developing markets. And those banks were asking Rabo, it's very nice that you provide advisory, but it would be even better if you could invest in our banks. And in 2005, late CEO Bert Heemskerk decided, okay, let's put our money where our mouth is. Let's also take shares in selected rural banks to make them really better. And since then, 2005, Rabo Development started. It's like a combination of equity investments in selected banks. It's providing management support. It's not just being a passive investor. It's a very active investment strategy with managers provided by Rabobank. Advisory services provided by, let's say, the old RIAS unit. And a very close cooperation with the government, Dutch government, Dutch embassies, local governments, NGOs and multilaterals. And in the end, basically the key goal, what we want to achieve with it, is access to finance, especially in rural areas where access to finance is at this moment maybe 20% or less. And that should go, in the end, on a profitable way. That's very important. Maybe we take a longer-term view, But in the end, it should be profitable to be sustainable. So since 2005, we built up a portfolio of 8 investments. Clearly, our focus is on sub-Saharan Africa. But we also have taken together with IFC a share in URCB Bank. It's a rural bank in Zhejiang province in China. We are in South America in Sicredi. It's a cooperative bank in Brazil. Banco Regional in Paraguay. But again, Africa has our focus. We have investments in the NMB Bank, Tanzania. Robert Pascal will tell you more about that. Zanaco, Zambia. Banco Terra, Mozambique. And Banque Populaire, Rwanda. And recently we took a share in DFCU Bank, Uganda. In the end, our goal is to turn around these banks into profitable, let's say, commercial banks with strong rural orientation. And that's not an easy trajet. So it's you have to have a long-term vision. And that's very important. And what is also important, you have to involve rural stakeholders into your strategy and into the bank. Because if in your shareholder structure there are no rural stakeholders, the vision and the mission of the bank, you can say we will focus on rural mission, it will go away from agriculture. That's an important lesson learned. We always show sort of the farmer pyramid, or the agricultural pyramid, because you don't have something like agri-financing. Agri-financing is very diversified. It very much depends on the segment, and the previous speakers also showed that. And where Rabo International would focus on the wholesale, on the top of the pyramid, large commercial farmers, large corporates. Rabo Foundation focuses on the cooperatives. Rabo Development pretty much on the whole pyramid with a focus on the SMEs, mid-sized. Subsistence farmers, farmers that do not consistently produce a marketable surplus, basically are a very difficult segment for a bank. But what you can do, and what Rabo Development is anyway doing, is providing accounts. Because financial inclusion starts with accounts, with saving accounts, current accounts. If subsistence farmers migrate to higher segments, then you can talk about crediting them. So, we tell a little bit about cooperative principles. The primary objective of a cooperative, we'll say, is to maximize the benefits members derive from their business transactions with the cooperative. So, the cooperative is there for the members. It's a margin optimizer for members. Also, bridge the gap between the small farmer or the farmer, not necessarily small farmers, also farmers, and the market. So bargaining power. But at the same time, it should be set up according to the criteria of an industrial organization. It should not be that much different from private peers. So maximize market revenues for the members and minimize cost of production for the members. Be efficient, well organized. All right, it sounds pretty easy, but as we all know, you will not see a lot of cooperatives in developing markets that meet these criteria. But at the same time, farmer members also need to understand the cooperative, the regulations of the cooperative, and comply to it. It's a two-way street. The management of a cooperative has to be, has to have enough integrity and be there for the members, and the members have to be loyal to the cooperative. You can divide the cooperative structure in a governance part, which is the association, and in an enterprise part. Members will choose the board. The board will hire management. Management will hire staff. Basically, the association governors, so the board, will be there on a voluntary basis, whereas the staff and management is remunerated. And ideally, you have a control board to control the actions of the board and management. So, key success factors for cooperatives stick to economic and business-like principles. Governance structure is very important. Don't mix up governance with management. That's something you see in many cases. Consistent business discipline, good communication with members, and clear and business-like legislation. So we always talk about three key principles. Serve at cost, the proportionality principle, and the principle of self-financing. Well, so what do we mean with that? So in principle, the cooperative should not create an independent profit for the sake of the cooperative, but it should basically organize a margin for its members. Still, at the same time, the cooperative should make enough reservations, enough surplus, to build up its own capitalization. Non-members, I think that's important, they should be subject to profit maximization. So a cooperative typically would deal differently with members and non-members in terms of the price or the bonus they would pay. Proportionality. Basically, cooperative will allocate returns and cost proportional with the members' turnover. It will also be stated in the members' rights and duties, so including liabilities and voting rights. And proportionality will be applied in reservation according to the member turnover. If you don't use proportionality, you will lose the bigger, more progressive farmers. Yeah, so you have to come to the right balance between equality and proportionality in a cooperative, and that's sometimes a big challenge. What we mean with principle of self-financing is that cooperatives cannot go to the market for capital. And that's also in our own bank, in Rabo, sometimes a constraint, because we are purely depending on our internal profits, internal reservations. And member capital. Of course, for secondary operations, cooperatives can team up with private companies in joint ventures. That's something else. But the cooperative itself, capital comes from members and profits. If you talk about the business practices, you can say a couple of things. Prices and conditions are uniform for all members, so the cooperative should not negotiate with its members on that. That's in principle uniform. If you talk about operational matters, they typically lay down in a product regulation, so to make it clear for all the members. And in marketing cooperatives, 100% delivery duty of members is really key to come to enough volume. Especially marketing cooperatives, they have a high fixed asset base. They typically have logistics and they have sometimes processing. So they have quite a high fixed cost level. They need volume to cover their cost. Input cooperatives may be a different story, but marketing cooperatives, you know, side selling can be deadly for cooperatives. Challenge for cooperatives is to pay out the right price to its members, especially fluctuating prices through the season. In developing countries, you will see middlemen around cooperatives trying to sweeten the farmers with good prices, good cash prices. At the same time, the cooperative must be careful not to pay too much as a first payment to its members, because then it could compromise on its margin to cover its cost. It could become loss-making. So the cooperative needs to balance between paying the right price and making sure it has to have enough cushion when the prices would drop. If you look at the reservation policy of cooperatives, I think it's a very important point, because if you do not make enough reservations as a cooperative, banks will not be interested in you. That's very clear. And unfortunately, reservation and capitalization is not always high on the agenda. Typically, if you have the total income of sales, you deduct the operating cost, you deduct the cost of purchasing the products, and then what what you will have is a surplus which is available for the members, right? Now, the surplus is very important. You can, of course, you have a legal reserve obligation, mostly like 20%, 25%. But the 75% left, yeah, many members will say, please pay to the members in a second payment or a bonus. If you do that, you will not capitalize your cooperative well. So there must be enough discipline in the cooperative to, on top of the general reserve, make an additional reservation. And what happens is that, and a good idea is to use the concept of member accounts. So not to have a general reservation, but to make it specific to individuals through member accounts. I come back later on that. Just one of the examples how important capitalization is, and I come back also later on this example. We are quite active in Vietnam in cooperative development advisory, and we work with a coffee cooperative. And this coffee cooperative basically was set up according to the principles I just mentioned. If they would have just stopped at their member capital, what you see is that the paid-in capital is gradually increasing with new members joining, but it would stay a very undercapitalized cooperative, and banks will never be interested. So what was agreed is that they will retain earnings 20% legal, but on top of that 30% voluntarily by the members. And that is creating a well-capitalized cooperative. You will see it's expected in 2015, equity about, one-third of total balance sheet. And that's not very bad for, this is even an input cooperative. So that's quite solid. Still, enticing banks to finance cooperatives is a challenge also in Vietnam. So first looking at financing mature cooperatives, let's say in Europe or the US. In Rabobank, we have rating systems to rate wholesale companies, right? That's basically based on the probability of default. Now, if you look at a cooperative and you're not aware of certain differences, you may underrate the quality of the cooperative. So there, we summarized it in 5 key differences, which you may take into account when looking at cooperatives. The solvency and member liability of a cooperative is really something special. In the past, in Holland, for example, the members were also liable for all the losses and for debt of a cooperative. Now, if you look at the cooperative, you will not see that. It's like an off-balance guarantee, so to say. So you have to know if there are guarantees or liabilities at the member level. Nowadays, it's quite rare in the Netherlands, so you have sort of limited or no liability at all. But for example, in Africa or not, in developing countries, often the board members, give guarantees to guarantee the debt. So that's something special about cooperatives. Member linkages is also special, especially marketing cooperatives, where you have a exclusive supply duty and right of members. 10 minutes, okay. That's a big asset for such a company, for a cooperative. Private companies do not have such a guaranteed supply. And rating systems will not take that into account. So you may want to adjust for that in your rating. Profitability. In principle, cooperatives should pay a higher price to their members than private companies. So in principle, the profitability of the cooperative will be lower if you compare it to a private peer. Right? So your first suggestion, if you look at it, hey, this cooperative, they're doing something wrong. But maybe if you adjust for the price, then you can make a sort of adjusted profitability of the cooperative to see if it's really less profitable or just paying a better price. The member self-financing. Member accounts, I think, are key to the cooperative. You have capital member accounts and debt accounts. Capital accounts, basically, you get part of the member's profit is put on as capital in that account, and it's available only at retirement or when he's exiting the cooperative. But in general, exiting a cooperative is not that easy, or there are certain certain restrictions to take away your member capital. Member debt, you can also build that out of the member turnover to retain certain part of the surplus on the member debt, and it's often subordinated to normal debt. So you can almost see it as risk-bearing capital as well. So the combination of member capital, member debt, gives additional, I would say, strengths to a cooperative, which private companies do not have. Especially if it's sticky, the member debt, if there are strong restrictions to take out this debt, then it's quite a big asset, and it's not taken into account in your rating system. Corporate governance can be not only an asset, but also a risk. If there's too much influence of the members in the governance, in the board of cooperatives, there may be a focus, or it may be skewed to optimizing member benefits and forgetting about the long-term, the long-term goals of the cooperative. Especially cooperatives that get into problems when there's a strong member representation in the board, banks have to be very careful. If you go to developing countries, the issues are not much different. The only thing is, I think you even more have to understand the value chain and the linkages of the cooperatives. Because I haven't seen many cooperatives in developing countries that are financiable on a standalone basis, just by looking at the financials. In the end, you always want to know, how is this cooperative, this farmer group, integrated forward and backward, but especially forward. What is also typical is that there are not many cooperatives involved in added value. You see cooperatives selling paddy and selling cocoa or selling coffee, but adding value is, I think, very important, and forward market linkages. One exception, for example, in Rwanda is you have a model whereby ICM, it's an Australian rice miller, has joint ventures with cooperative unions in rice milling. That gives a very strong commitment of the cooperatives under that union to supply the paddy to the mill, because they get a dividend. And I think could be an important model to increase, let's say, the efficiency of supply chains, to improve the income of farmers. Forward integration, of course, the question is, where do co-ops get the capital to invest? So you may even need processors to grant, so to say, piece of their shares to cooperatives. And cooperatives can, against a loan, and in 10-year time, the loan can be repaid by the cooperative by supplying product. You have to be creative, but forward integration is very important. Of course, assessing cooperatives is not an easy job, especially for bankers. Also, in our partner banks, they're sometimes struggling with that. So we, within Rabo, we have developed a simple, so to say, cooperative scorecard template. Scoring cooperatives on some key elements. You have to adjust it per sector, because technically, of course, the dairy cooperatives are different from coffee cooperatives, etc. But it can help, it can guide bankers in their assessment. We think it's important that the bankers fill it in themselves, because it helps them in their relationship also with the cooperative to discuss their issues, discuss all the key parameters with the cooperative. And in the end, they have a better understanding of cooperatives. In terms of key financing products for cooperatives, Robert will go into warehouses seed finance especially. Working capital is often the first financing product provided by banks. You can distinguish input finance and raw material collection finance. I'm not talking about asset finance at this moment. Input finance, of course, is to be given early in the season. It's typically, I would say, 20%. It covers 20% of the revenues of a cooperative, more or less, depending on what you take into account. I think that could be a benchmark. So if you do it well, you have quite a big cover of the revenues of the cooperative compared to your loan, right? I mean, so in that sense, input finance is, I would say, less risky. But of course, what is risky is that you are sitting out the whole crop cycle. So input finance also requires strong monitoring of the group, of the crop, and an active relationship manager. In terms of structure, a three-party agreement with the supplier could help, whereby the bank directly pays out to the supplier rather than paying cash to the cooperative. If you look at raw material collection finance, cooperative needs money, needs cash at the right moment. If it doesn't have the cash at the right moment, the middleman will come by and will pick up or will make sure or could lead to supply problems of the cooperative. So that it's important that in time the bank and the cooperative determine the amount of finance needed to buy up the raw material. Raw material, of course, is typically a much higher amount than input finance, right? So I think it's very important in these type of structures that a bank looks at the marketing construction behind it, the contract. Because, again, collateral typically will be an issue at cooperatives, especially if you've already done an input finance. So the contract and the forward linkages and the track record between the cooperative and the buyer is key. So if you have a contract, you could say, okay, let's say we finance 60% of the contract, depending on the volatility of prices, etc. Ideally, you work with a borrowing base, which means that you only finance the value of the crop that the cooperative has collected. But in many cases, the crop is run through the warehouse in such a speed that a borrowing base is not practical. So then you will have to look at the contract. You will have to disburse in stages based on crop or on commodity reports of the cooperative. So you will have to track the commodity flow rather than using a borrowing base. And so it's not an easy one. It depends per crop and per situation. Two cases which show the complexity also of improving agricultural finance. Basically, this is Vietnam. We have worked in Vietnam on different levels. We have worked with the government on improving the cooperative law, which was, I say, paternalistic and over-regulated. So the law is now more business-oriented, leaves more freedom to cooperatives. We work with banks, local banks, in this case the People's Credit Fund, to improve their agricultural, appetite and skills. At the same time, we support cooperatives in their development. And in the end, the idea is that all these three elements getting on the same, I would say, level. Because we can work a lot with cooperatives, but if the banks say no, it's all to no avail. For example, practical situation is that Rabo Foundation at this stage is still financing the cooperative, already for the second year, I think. And now hopefully the bank will, come in because of capitalization build-up. Mozambique example, company called Ilovo from South Africa. It's a big sugar producer. Coincidentally, they are quite active in all the countries where we have our partner banks. And their typical structure would be they have their own plantation, say 70% of the of the of their crop needs, and 30% of the crop needs come from outgrowers. Now, outgrowers are organized in associations. So we have worked with these associations to get more professional and bankable. Banco Terra, our partner bank, has financed the associations, the inputs, beginning of the crop season, based on offtake contracts and a tripartite agreement between Ilovo, Banco Terra, and the associations. RIAS, so the advisory arm of Rabo Development, we have helped, we've worked with Banco Terra on this structure, and we advise the associations also on bankability issues. What you see is that in principle the structure works now, but it was not an easy one. Quickly, the conclusions. Okay, cooperatives can be an ideal organization for farmers to increase bargaining power, add value to their raw material, in theory, but they really need to stick to business principles. Developed markets, 60% of food and agribusiness is controlled by cooperatives. But of course, 100 years ago, these co-ops also were very small, and they have merged and merged and merged into only a small group of very large cooperatives. As a bank, you have to understand the difference between cooperatives and private organizations to make sure your credit assessment is correct. Developing countries, I think the cooperatives still have a way to go, especially on capitalization. So capacity building will stay an integral part of banks, I would say. And the bank doesn't need to do that themselves, but at least the bank should organize capacity building, maybe by external parties. Scorecards, like we saw also with farmers, scorecards can be a good tool to guide bankers in risk assessment. In the end, bankers need to understand the cooperatives' ins and outs. So that's always, I think, the risk with scorecards. That people just fill in the scorecard but do not really understand sort of the outcome or the background of the scorecard, right? So I think bankers themselves should be involved in that. And the value chain approach, I think we all agree with that, is crucial, not only financing farmers, but also when working with cooperatives. So thank you very much for your attention. And sorry to be between you and lunch. Thank you.